Sir, can you express what is your what you are doing in this particular program and how it can be better for the society of the India soon?
We all know that prevention is better than a treatment of established coronary heart disease, because coronary heart disease is increasing all over India, and Indians seems to have a special predilection to develop coronary heart disease and heart attacks. The reason why Indians have a high prevalence of coronary heart disease is mainly because of increased risk factors which are poorly managed. Because the risk factors for coronary heart disease are high blood pressure, diabetes, high cholesterol and smoking, and then physical inactivity and obesity and psychological stress. All these are poorly managed in among Indians, and that is the reason why Indians have high prevalence of coronary heart disease. And secondly, even if they have coronary heart disease, they are not well treated after the secondary prevention efforts are less effective. There are efficient institutions where acute care is being provided all over India, and new centers are coming up. There are new centers for angioplasty and bypass surgery coming up in all over India. But the prevention is probably getting a backseat. Because even after undergoing angioplasty or surgery, many people after 1 to 2 years down the line, they don't follow the secondary prevention guidelines, and that adds to the mortality due to coronary artery disease. So our efforts as in the Preventive Council is to rectify these mistakes, because we are, India is committed to the World Heart Organization, World Health Organization and World Heart Federation motto of 25 by 25, by reducing the coronary heart disease mortality by 25% by year 2025. And the emphasis by the World Health Organization and World Heart Federation is to address to all the risk factors, but concentrate on improving hypertension control, then prevention of smoking or smoking cessation, and improving secondary prevention. So this we have been trying. We have conducted conferences. We are interacted with the government, and we are popularizing among the professional organizations and other non-government organizations. Yes.
Okay. So, sir, this regarding the preventive part, for the patient perspective, what is your step? That how you, this concept will reach to the patient directly.
Patients need to be told that I think taking good care of the risk factors is important. For example, high blood pressure. Around 28 to 30% of adult Indians have high blood pressure. However, a large majority of these people are not aware that they have high blood pressure. In fact, in our study, which we did in Kerala, we found that only 30 to 40% of patients with hypertension are aware that they have high blood pressure. I think the scenario cannot be different in rest of India. Also, there are some limited studies from North India, Bombay, all showed the same thing. People have high blood pressure, 28 to 30% in the population, similar to in the West and other developing countries, same prevalence rate for hypertension. But there the control rate, that awareness rate is much better. In US, the awareness of high blood pressure, that is knowing that they have high blood pressure, is around 80%. Our awareness is 40-45%. Then even if people are aware about their high blood pressure, they are not treated properly. The control of hypertension is around 17% in India, while it is around 50% in the developed world. So there is a huge gap between what is desirable and what you have now here in India. This is for high blood pressure. Then the smoking campaign is taking some effect. The government has committed to promote cessation by ads and other things which are slow, and the banning smoking in public. But these things are working very well, but people who are smoking, already smoking, the quitting rate is not very high. We are preventing the young people, maybe we are preventing young people from starting smoking, but people who are, in our study in Kerala also same thing, the younger generation prevalence rate of smoking has come down, but the elderly population, they continues to smoke. And one reason why we thought they continue to smoke is because of the unfamiliarity of doctors to advise them properly how to stop smoking. Most doctors are not knowledgeable when it comes to the proper advice to stop smoking, because there are already well defined behavioral therapy, then drug therapy for cessation of smoking, established one. But many doctors, I would say most doctors, are not aware about this, and they don't put this into practice when they treat a patient who smoke. That's the problem. Okay. There are other areas also, high blood pressure, high cholesterol, diabetes, then physical inactivity. Okay. The promoting physical activity is should be a priority area, but now the people are buying two-wheelers like anything. Our roads are does not have pedestrian footpath in many areas, and walking is a big risk in our heavily congested roads. And the space available, public parks, they are now shrinking. So people don't have adequate opportunities for relaxation and physical activity. That is a collective combined effort is required, not only by the doctors has to recommend physical activity, but also the government and the local bodies should try to promote. The government is aware about this. That is why the special instructions and special papers, white papers have been issued regarding this, the need for when you plan a city. For example, the New Bombay, they have very wide, I am told that they have very wide footpaths, and new cities which are coming up, new city is possible, but the existing cities, they are very congested now, and physical activity is coming down.
Okay, so definitely it's a very nice thought of that for prevention in cardiovascular disease in various segments like the myocardial infarction, diabetes, and also the physical inactivity, which is a very common now. We can see because of the technologies is available so widely. So it is also is a worst part is that the patient, people have become very very lazy, and they are dependent on the various kind of the instruments. So now, sir, we have talked regarding the prevention. Now definitely as a physician, you as a consultant, you must have seen the many patient regarding the acute coronary syndrome. There may be some patient on arrhythmic disorders like atrial fibrillation, and you have heard that the stroke is one of the major complication of atrial fibrillation.
That's right.
And ACS and stroke both are, we can say it's a top two factors which can have the highest mortality in worldwide also as well.
That's right.
So what's your take on that? If the both diseases are there, though they are incomparable, but how they can impact the patient's life for a lifetime?
Oh, that's right. Because they are, even though both are, one is the atrial fibrillation and arrhythmic event, and coronary heart disease involve the myocardium and the blood vessels. However, people with an acute coronary syndrome may have left ventricular dysfunction, left atrial enlargement, which predispose them to develop atrial fibrillation. And secondly, during a course of acute coronary syndrome, if they develop atrial fibrillation, the mortality is high, and the chance of a thromboembolic event is very high. So I think this acute coronary syndrome and atrial fibrillation often coexist. Yes. And its treatment is very important because it is treatable. Atrial fibrillation can be controlled, the rate can be controlled, the thromboembolic events can be controlled. And acute coronary syndrome and atrial fibrillation can be managed effectively if proper treatment is given at the right time.
Okay. So definitely, this prevention is very, very important for both the condition. even if because the stroke is a major complication, and if we diagnose the AF as soon as possible, as you said, it's a treatable. So you can control the rate and rhythm, and also you can prevent the stroke. So this is just last question is for you, sir, that for the management of stroke in atrial fibrillation, you must have heard about the antithrombotics, the various generation of antithrombotics, from the aspirin, warfarin, VKs. Now the newer generation, sir, is also available, like the rivaroxaban, dabigatran, and apixaban. So what is your take on this particular generation of treatment, that you started aspirin, then warfarin, now it's a newer generation? What difference you have find, how it can be more and more better for the AF patients?
Now for atrial fibrillation patients, or for any patient, a stroke is a very devastating complication, because it causes a lot of disability and problems to the family, and it is something which need to be prevented. Now, atrial fibrillation certainly predispose a patient to develop stroke, and the prevalence and the chance of atrial stroke in any patient with atrial fibrillation is very high. Now, previously we thought probably aspirin and other antiplatelet drugs will be effective in preventing thromboembolic complications after atrial fibrillation, but many studies have shown that this is not enough. Aspirin and other antiplatelet drugs are not effective in preventing the stroke in atrial fibrillation. So the time-tested and proven medication was the vitamin K antagonist, warfarin, and other related compounds. And they are proven to be very, very effective. The problem is the compliance. It's a very unreliable drug, oral anticoagulants. There are several problems, because you need to check the prothrombin time periodically. How frequently you need to check is variable, but mostly at least once in a month. And there are some patients whom the prothrombin time is so variable that you need to check prothrombin time once in a week. Now, this is a big problem. Our labs are not well standardized. So that people check the prothrombin time and get an INR value in from one lab, and then immediately they go and check another, you get a diametrically totally different, not even 20%, from 6.8. I have seen patients with the INR value of 6.8 from one laboratory, then another lab giving a value of 1.8. So such a huge difference is because of the methodological inaccuracies and the different kits employed which are not well standardized. So there's a lot of issues. And then patients sometimes you put on oral anticoagulants, vitamin K antagonist, and then report a patient who seldom test for prothrombin time. I have seen patient who comes back after 6 or 8 months saying that they never bothered to check for prothrombin time. Either they are aware, but they thought that is not very important. So I think the almost all doctors and cardiologists and people treating these patients with atrial fibrillation for prevention of stroke are frustrated, has been frustrated. There have been good results, but the bleeding complications, intracranial bleed, and deaths have occurred in large. I used to tell my patients before starting an oral anticoagulant, even if they have atrial fibrillation, I will tell them, if you don't have, I don't want a patient of mine, I don't want you to die due to an intracranial hemorrhage, which is a strong possibility when you are taking on oral anticoagulant. So unless if you are not comfortable in checking your INR periodically, better accept the risk of stroke rather than continue on vitamin K antagonist. And many times I am proven right, and I had to treat patients who comes with intracranial bleeding or massive GA bleeding. So one maybe a solution which has emerged of recent time is the newer oral anticoagulants. There are several molecules now, the newer oral anticoagulants, they are effective, and there's no need to monitor these patients with a periodic prothrombin time, which I find is a tremendous advantage for the patients. The problem there is about the compliance part, because these drugs will have to be taken without fail. Advantage of vitamin K antagonist is if you stop the vitamin K antagonist, the effect doesn't disappear immediately.
Yes.
But these newer oral anticoagulants, if you stop one day, the effect goes immediately. And then the risk of stroke returns. Or so I think and the cost factor. Because the chances of non-compliance is very high because the cost of the medication is also high. That I think is one factor. So I think I don't know how to solve this problem. If more and more people have proper medical insurance, I think this problem could have been solved. But I think that trend is happening. Now people are taking aware about this and taking more medical insurance. That is one way to go about it. But however, I feel that considering the scenario, if newer oral anticoagulants are available at a competitive price, I would prefer to use these agents rather than the conventional oral anticoagulants because of the very dismal a difficult experience of controlling the INR in some patients.
Okay. So, I think Dr. Zakaria has given very in-depth regarding the knowledge of, first of all, the prevention part of the cardiovascular disease, because it's now very challenging that before this is happening, how we can prevent that disease and so that mortality and morbidity benefit can have the patients as well. And regarding the stroke prevention in atrial fibrillation, very common and practical point he has raised that regarding the prothrombin time monitoring and INR monitoring. This is a very critical situation when patient is on older part. So the newer generation molecule has that advantage and which can increase the effect and the safer side also as well. But again, the compliance is also there with the newer generation because of a higher price of as of now what is available there in India. So sir, thanks a lot for providing your time and your all the valuable opinions. Thanks.